Hey guys, how's it going? Hope you're doing well. My name is Crown, and today I'm going to read you some very interesting stories that I hope that you're gonna love. And now, without further ado, let's go! To give you a bit of background, I'd like to explain how this situation has seriously affected me. About 6 years ago, I developed several health conditions that interacted with each other, creating a domino effect of health problems. Over the past 6 years, including this year, I have been hospitalized 15 times, each stay lasting at least a week. Despite stabilizing most of my conditions, I still face several challenges. The first is a heart condition. My pump capacity is at 35%, necessitating a pacemaker, in addition to dealing with one leaking valve. The reduced heart function and frequent hospital stays have significantly weakened my legs. I now walk unsteadily with a cane. To effectively retrain my legs, I require a Rollator, which is a four-wheeled stroller with a seat. Additionally, my legs are so weak that I lack the strength to lift or push myself upstairs, and particularly struggle to get up from the floor or ground if I fall. Once I'm down, it typically requires the assistance of 2 to 3 people to help me stand up again. So one day, I went to a store to grab some food and medical supplies. Won't say the store's name, but they usually wear Smurf-colored vests. I slowly toddle walk into the store, and that day I am wearing black jeans with holes, bright red suspenders to hold the pants up due to all the weight I've lost, a white short-sleeved dress shirt, and a very bright and loud red, green, and goldish-colored plaid vest. I don't even make it past the security sensors when I'm suddenly grabbed from behind by a woman who looks like she's never worked a day in her life and done up to the nines, so she looks like she should be shopping at high retail stores in New York or Paris instead of this local place. I'm going to call her Snooty. I know they usually call these ladies Karen, but my bonus mom's name is Karen, and she has never treated me badly, so Snooty it is for me. As stated, I didn't even make it past the security sensors at the building entrance when Snooty grabs me from behind by my right elbow and attempts to spin me around. I shift as best I can, Rollator and all, and see this high-faulting lady with an exceptionally annoyed look on her face. Snooty. Excuse me, did you not see me try to flag you down? How could you miss us? You walked right past me and my crippled daughter. Her daughter isn't crippled. In fact, all she has on is a brace boot around her left ankle and foot. Me? Lost in a little bit of confusion. I'm sorry. I thought you were waving at someone you knew in the parking lot. Do I know you? Snooty. No, you don't, but you should pay attention to customers when you bring in the handicapped items, such as that wheelchair. I flagged you down because my daughter needs it. Me? Stammering a lil. I'm sorry, but this isn't a wheelchair. Snooty. Yes, it is. The store provides them for handicapped customers, and you need to do your job and give this one to us. Me. That's not my job. In fact, I don't have a job. I'm in the middle of getting approved for disability. Snooty. Really? What a world. Anyone thinks they can get away with lying and excuses? Just give me the wheelchair, and I'll be nice and won't report you. Me. I don't work here, lady. Snooty. Yes, you do. You're wearing a vest, and this is one of the store's wheelchairs. She places a hand on one of the bars on my Rollator and grips tightly. Me. No. I do not work here, lady. I am a customer. I'm not wearing the right kind of vest. This item doesn't belong to the store. It's not a wheelchair, it's a Rollator. And the store doesn't provide wheelchairs, they provide scooters, which are located behind you. Let go of my walker. Snooty attempts to jerk the Rollator from me. I'm going to report you for being rude to customers, especially ones who are handicapped. You're not following the ADA laws. That'll get you fired for certain. Me, pulling back on my Rollator. Again, I do not work here. This doesn't belong to the store. It belongs to me. It's not a wheelchair. And your daughter isn't handicapped. She has an ankle brace on, probably meaning she just twisted or sprained her ankle. Grab her a scooter if you want, but leave me alone. Snooty. More lies. I am taking this wheelchair, and I am going straight to the head manager to have you fired. What happens next is a tug of war, to the best of my ability, between myself and the lady with my Rollator. She eventually does something kind of intelligent, and she pushes on one of my pulls, which causes me to stumble backward eventually tripping over my own feet and kaboom, down I go to the floor, landing on my right butt cheek and my shoulder, and head slamming to the floor. I'm in a tremendous amount of pain. The room and my head is spinning. The lady is saying something to me in scolding tones, shaking her finger at me, but my head is ringing. I'm now short of breath, so I don't really hear her, nor understand her. She huffs and walks away, and I was told she was slightly cursing as she was having troubles trying to push her daughter around in the wheelchair. Note, rollators are made so you walk facing the seat, thus the handlebars face out away, not from behind the seat. Several minutes go by. Folks are trying to help me get up. Finally, there comes a gentleman, and I believe his two sons, all of whom look like they could be professional linebackers, who managed to get me up and escort me to one of the benches just inside the entrance doors. Just a couple minutes more, and the store manager and a security guard come walking up to me with very stern looks upon their faces. Store manager, we understand you were trying to take a wheelchair from a handicapped customer, and that you were. Glancing up and down at me. Well, obviously, attempting to pass yourself off as an employee of our store. Me. No, I was trying to come in here to buy some groceries and medical items when this woman accosted me, telling me I needed to give her my rollator. Store security. Well, this woman said you tried to manhandle her to take it away from her. I explained my medical conditions and how it's impossible for me to be able to manhandle anyone at the present time or foreseeable future. The man and sons who helped pick me up informed the manager and security that I had to be picked up off the floor, that I had no leg strength as far as they could tell. After this, the manager and security looked me over and then looked at each other with expressions that said this needed to be looked into further. The store security called for another security officer to have him slash her find the lady and her daughter and bring them up to the front of the store. When they arrive, Snooty starts right on in. Snooty, you've got the right, or should I say the wrong man. He needs to be fired, now. And I have a good mind to press charges against him and the store for assaulting me. Store manager, ma'am, I can't fire him as he doesn't work here. Snooty, yes he does. He's wearing one of your vests. Store manager, you mean a vest like this? He raises up the side of the vest he's wearing. It looks nothing like our vests, ma'am. It also doesn't have our name nor our logo on it. Snooty. Well then, he tried to impersonate an employee so he could attack the disabled. I still wish to press charges. Store security. Ma'am, he says the stroller is his. Snooty, this is not his wheelchair. Me. It's not a wheelchair. If she owned it, she'd know it's not one. Also, if it was hers, why does she have my wallet and prescription list in the basket under the seat? Snooty. That shows why you're not the owner. There's no basket under the seat. The store security politely helps her daughter out of the rollator and onto a bench seat, walks over and flips the seat up, revealing a little basket which contains my wallet and my newest list of prescriptions to order. Snooty now looks up wide-eyed and somewhat terrified. Store security tells his partner to make sure Snooty doesn't go anywhere. Store manager and store security proceed up the staircase to the manager and security offices. They are gone for about 20 minutes, and then come back. Store security informs Snooty that the incident was all caught on camera and proves she is the one who started everything, accosted me, and then walked off with my rollator. She starts screaming and threatening the store security and store manager with lawsuits and such, but is cut off when an ambulance crew arrives, followed by the local police. The ambulance crew got the gurney prepped for me with the backboard and neck brace. Not that I needed it, but with the fall, they have to make sure I'm extra stable and taken in to see if I have anything wrong with my neck, back, or a concussion. They get me loaded and I'm waiting a few minutes when the police come back from the offices and ask me what I'd like to do. I can be a forgiving guy, usually given my mood and circumstances, but I was still hurting in utter disbelief at what this lady did and pissed off beyond all feeling. I let her have it. I told the officers I wanted to press charges for assault and battery, if I could get it, as well as theft of my rollator and my wallet. I'm not sure what all happened to the lady, although I know she didn't help herself out. As I was being rolled out the doors on the gurney, I saw her break away from the police, take a defensive stance, and then she started flailing and smacking the officers with her purse and arms, as well as kicking their legs with her pricey, name-brand pumps. It didn't take long before they had her face down on the ground, knees in her back, and the handcuffs becoming the next bit of bling around her wrists, looking oh so plain compared to her bracelets. I didn't have to do anything. About a week later, I got a letter from the county courthouse informing me that her case was already heard. The store video, store manager and store security's testimony, as well those from a couple of other people who came forward after realizing what it was they saw when they walked past us, was more than enough to convict her. I don't know if she served time in jail or community service, but either way, I hope she got to be seen in something either bright orange or maybe an old-fashioned little black and white striped dress. Update information. Apparently, Snooty did make a plea deal the morning after her night in jail when she appeared in front of the judge. My understanding is she pled guilty and served jail time for assaulting the police officers, resisting arrest, assaulting me, and some other charges that were listed, but they were in high legalese that I've not heard of, so not sure what they were about. Since she pled guilty to those items, the judge went lenient on her for the theft of my wallet. She, not knowing the Rollator had a basket, nor knowing or being able to see what was in the basket. Not sure what he did about her taking my Rollator. She was also ordered to pay for my ambulance, ER visit, x-rays, scans, and prescriptions specifically related to my injuries from the incident, as well as being ordered to seek mental counseling and evaluation. So, I guess the only thing left that folks have hoped she will pay for, or I should do, is sue for pain and suffering and the like in a civil case. My lawyers assisting me with filling out and filling my forms for disability, etc., have already talked with me and submitted a civil case against her. The first hearing is apparently in 4 to 5 months from now. Don't have my date book in front of me. Working as the manager of a local tow truck company, I often found myself caught in the middle of chaotic situations. Our city was known for its treacherous roads, especially up in the hills where sharp turns and unpredictable weather conditions made driving a real challenge. We served a crucial role during heavy rain periods when these roads became almost impassable for cargo trucks. Our owner, a sweet old lady, always did her best to support the truck drivers during these tough times. One of our initiatives to assist these hard-working individuals involved providing them with free coffee and snacks at the truck stops. It was a small gesture of appreciation for their challenging work. The costs weren't overly burdensome, especially considering the lucrative contracts we had due to those perilous roads. It was also a way to educate regular drivers about the challenges of navigating those hills. Every week, I made the rounds to the local truck stops to settle accounts and ensure everyone was compensated properly. I could have easily handled this task with a couple of phone calls or messages, but I relished any opportunity to escape the confines of my office. The workload could be brutal at times, and getting out and about was a welcome respite. The owner never minded me taking on this responsibility, knowing how hard we all worked. At the truck stops, I was known as the guy who footed the bill for the truckers' coffee and food. While I always emphasized that it was the company covering these expenses, the drivers were incredibly grateful. They appreciated not only the freebies, but also the respect and dignity with which we treated them. Then there was that fateful day last summer, in the midst of a ferocious storm that inundated us with work. We spent hours helping our 22 drivers locate and retrieve people's cars, all while fielding an unending barrage of calls for help. The relentless noise of ringing phones still echoed in my mind. We worked from 5 a.m. to 5 a.m., essentially pulling an all-nighter due to the worsening road conditions. As I finally headed home to get some much-needed rest, the owner offered to cover my weekly visit to the stops. I thanked her but insisted she skip one particular stop since it was conveniently on my way home. Our office was located a few miles outside the city. Upon arriving at my regular stop, I was greeted by the familiar faces of the regular truckers. We exchanged stories about the wild storm and chatted while I placed my order. Once my massive pile of food and enough coffee to thicken my blood arrived, I settled in for a feast. However, my peaceful meal was abruptly interrupted by a belligerent man's loud shouts. He was berating the cashier, yelling something like, What do you mean you can't help me? This is your job. I glanced back and thought, what a crazy jerk. It turned out to be Roger, although that's not his real name. He continued to scream at the cashier over some issue with his car's tires. I tried to tune out the commotion and focus on my meal, thinking I could finally relax. But then, I heard an irritated voice shout, "Hey you!" from behind me. Assuming I might be blocking someone's access to the condiments, I replied, "My bad," and moved the basket aside, continuing to eat. That's when I felt a heavy stomp on the floor, followed by someone yanking my shoulder and shouting, "Fire that awful employee immediately!" Startled, I turned to see Roger still yelling, his face contorted with anger. It seemed he had confused me for the manager due to my officer badge and clothes. I was utterly exhausted from one of the most stressful days of my life, and eating was my sacred refuge, so I simply shrugged him off and turned back to my meal, muttering, "Go screw yourself." I could hear the cashier giggling and the owner, whom I'll call Bob behind the counter, attending to customers. Bob burst into laughter and then calmly informed Roger that I was just another customer, not an employee. Roger, however, seemed unfazed by this revelation and launched into a tirade. "Roger, is that how you run your business then? Letting rude, incompetent cashiers treat your customers like garbage and allowing your other customers to harass me without consequences?" Bob gave me an apologetic look and said, "I'm terribly sorry you had to go through this, OP. I'll escort this gentleman out." Roger gasped dramatically, as if he couldn't believe it. "How dare you? You let your staff and customers harass good people like me? I'm calling the police, and based on the disgusting food I see here, I bet your kitchen is infested with rats and cockroaches. I'm calling for a health inspection too." I took great offense at his comments about the food. This place served some of the best food in town, and I wasn't going to let his insults slide. I retorted, "This food is 1,000 times better than whatever your wife does to you." Roger's face turned beet red, and he began to threaten me physically, hurling more obscenities my way. That's when I realized that the restaurant was filled with truckers who had been observing the scene. They weren't about to let one of their own be harassed like this. Amid the chaos, I heard a rough voice growl, "Hey, jerk, get the hell out of here!" When I turned to look, I saw 3 burly men, each wielding mechanical tools, and one even had a fire axe. They looked ready to defend us at all costs. My heart skipped a beat, and I froze in place, the sight of that axe sending a shiver down my spine. Roger also seemed taken aback by this sudden turn of events. He hastily retreated, still muttering threats and promises to call the police. The truckers followed him to the door, warning him that he'd better not come back. Eventually, the restaurant returned to its normal, peaceful atmosphere. Bob, the owner, came over to me and offered my meal for free as compensation for the trouble. I thanked him and realized that despite the craziness of the situation, it had ended on a positive note. The police arrived later, and we explained everything that had transpired. They asked if Bob wanted to press charges against Roger, to which he replied with a resounding, "Yes." If I learned anything from that day, it's the importance of having the right friends and being kind to truckers. They may be a rowdy bunch, but they'll always have your back when you need them. Just like those 3 heroes with their mechanical tools and that menacing fire axe. Several commenters tell me that you guys would enjoy this story. About 6 or 7 months ago, my neighbor got a drone. I don't mind people having hobbies, but for some reason, he insisted on flying like the biggest jerk possible. He would hover in front of other houses and windows trying to race cars going down the road. Worst of all, he had a habit of flying his drone in my fenced backyard buzzing over my dog, diving low just over my dog's head before circling around to do it again. My dog isn't small, he's about 70 pounds and a Malamute. But the drone terrified him and I was worried what would happen if it hit him. I asked my neighbor several times to please not fly in my yard and explained that it was scaring my dog. He basically told me to get lost and laughed in my face. When it still continued, I called the police. Unfortunately, there wasn't much they could do other than ask him to please not fly over my house / property. Finally, in late December, it happened. My dog got tired of this crab and managed to catch the drone right as it was diving towards him. He shredded the drone. The thing was just a jumbled mess of wires and plastic. The neighbor was pissed. He stormed over to my house swearing and threatening me, which I ignored. A week later, I got a summons to small claims court, and he wanted $900 for the cost of his drone and an additional $300 for supposedly denying him access to his property. The drone sat in my yard for a couple hours before it was retrieved. Screw that. He could have killed my dog. I don't have kids or a girlfriend. I just have my dog who has been my best friend for the past 7 years. That dog has moved with me 3 times. Was there when I graduated college, saw me buy my first house and my first new car. I love my dog. Went to legal advice and got some great help from them. Turns out, him suing me was the best thing to ever happen. When we got to small claims court, the judge basically laughed away his claims that I had intentionally trained my dog to attack his drone. Little did I know I was prepared. I had dozens of photos of my yard showing it was impossible for him to accidentally fly that low to my dog. Videos of him harassing my dog in the past, and I had saved all my medical bills from taking my dog to the vet. $700 for an x-ray, check. Another $250 to sedate him during. Why not? I don't want him to be uncomfortable. Full dental exam with tooth cleaning slash repair. $400. Then there was a cost of anti-anxiety meds and a secondary checkup, with food for a week in case his teeth were hurt, and extra just for good measure. In the end, the jerk ended up owing me almost $2,000, and now is being investigated by the FAA for not having a registered drone and violating several FAA regulations concerning drone flight. Too near an airport, too close to other people, out of sight of the operator and way above the maximum altitude. Enjoy never being allowed to fly drones again. I never mistook this job for low risk, but I never imagined it could potentially get me thrown in jail. We got a pretty sketchy delivery call at a late hour. Our FOH is constantly slammed with everyone desperate to eat at a table again now that the vaccine's out, and they were in the weeds. So I grabbed the phone. Before I could even finish our standard greeting, the guy just goes, "Yeah, it's Mac. I'm ordering a pizza." I'm not much for small talk either, so I'm rolling with it like, "Good for you, Mac. Pick up or delivery?" You know, just rattling all the standard questions. He answered the first few, but he seemed hesitant or confused. He argued with some other guy behind him for a second, then got back on a line and ordered like normal, as though none of the preceding stuff had even happened. Whatever. I caught his delivery and out I went. It was a standard large pizza. No toppings, no extras. They were going to pay cash. I pull up, and it's a scary rundown, sparsely populated apartment complex. Mostly pro-college students in there now though, so I wasn't too concerned or anything. I get to the door and when I knock, it eases open a bit. This didn't seem like the ideal neighborhood to keep your door unlocked, but not my business. I called in. "Hey, pizza." There was no response. I called a little louder. "Got your pizza out here." And an alarmed voice from inside was like, "Shh, come in. Just come in." No, I get that request weirdly a lot. Like everyone from sketchy apartment bros to suburban soccer moms asking me to bring the pizza to the dinner table because they are busy. Some people even pull this during the pandemic, but it's a long-standing company policy. A damn good one that's entering the home for any reason whatsoever is a hard no. So I sent back, "Can't do that, but I can leave it out here if you don't want to come to the door. Just need payment first." There was a silence and some shuffling and then a door shut and locked. And the guy was like, "What do you mean payment first? That's not what we agreed on." Through the closed door, I was standing there wondering if this was the first pizza this man had ever ordered in his life. Because payment first is basically implied, right? But I'm not looking for any confrontations or trying to be a jerk, so I just tell him, "Yeah, so our store policy is payment first." And he erupts screaming, "That's not what Mario and I discussed." So then I thought maybe he was trying to pull some kind of scam on us because nobody at our store is named Mario, and I'm the one who took his order. So I know what was discussed. I decided that they weren't going to pay, I'd made a reasonable attempt to deliver, and I could safely head out now. As I'm preparing to do so, another guy, looking back now, I realize he didn't even have a box, walks very confidently up to the door, pounds on it like a heavy bag, and grunts, "Pizza's here." I didn't know if this dude in the apartment had ordered two identical pizzas from different shops, or if our pizza had taken long enough that he thought we weren't coming and called someone else, or I had the wrong apartment, or what was happening. But it was weird enough that I decided to just go. Especially because the pizza guy number two was looking at me with a real intense stare. Way more malice than I'd ever be able to muster on behalf of defending the turf or our joint spies. He said something like, "Can I help you?" or "Wrong apartment?" or something along the lines of cordial, "Go the hell away." But I was already on my way out and didn't really process it. I went back to the shop, told the story to the chef, we laughed and guessed at what it could have been to drive this man to order two pizzas at once. I didn't think about it again for several weeks. Though several weeks later I was in the shop and a couple cops walk in. Not in uniform, but they have badges. They asked me if I've been at such and such apartment complex on such and such day, and I was like, "That was weeks ago. I have no idea where I was." So they were all like, "In that case, you wouldn't mind coming down to talk to us about what you do remember." But I was like, "Really, nothing." And they said, "Well, that's fine. Let's talk anyways and see if there is something you might not realize is relevant that comes back to you and all this stuff prodding me." I told him, "I'm working right now, but I can come later next week maybe." But they were really insistent, which should have set off some flags in hindsight. They were like, "Well, this is a really pressing matter and we'd appreciate if you came in right now. We will explain it to your boss so there won't be any problems. You'll really be helping us out." There not be able to chat to me at work should have been the first red flag. But I knew I had not done anything illegal, so it didn't cross my mind that I could be in any sort of trouble or have a reason to worry. Especially because when I got to the police precinct, everyone was extremely friendly, like I was actually doing them a favor. They didn't throw me in a cell or try to intimidate me or anything. They brought me in a nice air-conditioned conference room and gave me a comfortable chair and asked if I wanted anything to drink, and really just kind of shot the crap with me for 20 to 30 minutes. To this day, I'm still confused about this. I think they even offered to order food, if I remember right. I declined even the most basic offers because I was anxious to get back to my shift. Didn't need my co-workers getting any wrong ideas. I played along and made nice because they did get the okay from my boss to go as long as I needed. But in the back of my mind, I was like, "Didn't you say this was urgent? They are running short-staffed at work just so we can trade hot takes on a college baseball World Series?" Eventually, though, and I think they were trying to be subtle, but they definitely weren't, they shifted to asking me about what they really brought me in to talk about. They asked me about if I'd made the delivery to the apartment complex, and I'd obviously racked my brain between when the cops first arrived and then, so I told them actually I had. That I wasn't sure if it was exactly the day they were quoting me, but it was around then. I figured they would ask about the delivery, but didn't want to get ahead of their questions. I figured a brain dump of information would make me come off as guilty. Plus, I didn't want to accidentally tell them more than they were expecting to hear and land myself there longer. But instead of asking, like, any of the questions I expected they would ask, they said, "And how long had you known the guys you were delivering to?" Kind of confused, I responded, "I didn't." I could see that my answer disappointed them, but it was the truth. They collected themselves pretty quickly, though. There were two detectives, the same two who'd come for me in a store, and one kept insisting on the facts as they saw them, and the other kept trying to bend things in my favor. So the bend guy was like, "Okay, sure. Not like y'all are best friends or anything, but you at least knew them as customers, right?" I wasn't sure what "knew them as customers" was supposed to mean, because to me, it was synonymous with not knowing them. So I said no. They changed topics. They asked how long the delivery had been planned for. I told them everything had to be ordered the same day unless it was four or more pies, and I didn't remember exactly when they called, but per store policy, wouldn't have been more than an hour before it was delivered. Probably sooner, based on where they were relative to the store. We went back and forth like this for way longer than I was anticipating. Them asking me questions that seemed to imply I knew something, me feeling super confused and giving them visibly disappointing answers, reminding them I knew nothing. Eventually, they seemed pretty frustrated, and they were basically like, "Stop lying to us, man. Cut the crap. Your friends rolled on you. It's done." And I'm sitting here thinking, I have friends, but of course, in all seriousness, I was shocked by the change of tone because I had no clue what they were talking about. And I told them so, and they were both like, come on, man, you're just embarrassing yourself at this point. Was one trying to reassure me that if I just told them what I knew, they could still help me, and the other saying that I was too stupid to seize this last chance. Well, no reason to sit around and be spoken to like that. I got up to leave. And before I knew what was happening, I was being merendized. It was like a horror movie nightmare playing out in slow motion in front of my eyes. So I stopped with my, I want you to know that I want to get back to work, but I'm going to be chill out of courtesy, demeanor. And lost my crap at that point. I kept really, forcefully, without coming off as erratic or so I hoped, insisting that I did not even know what they were talking about, like I've been saying all along. They were not having any of it. They kept saying, videotape doesn't lie, man. You want to see the tape before you lock yourself into another lie? The jury is gonna eat this up. Jury, I nearly crap myself. I don't even turn right at red lights half the time. Plus, you had video all this time you were grilling me to remember what happened. And you could have just shown me a video? What the hell? I knew I was in over my head at this point. A million thoughts were swirling around and I was so overwhelmed and scared. I finally said what I should have said way back at the beginning, though I did not say it nearly assertively enough, because I was trying to, you know, act innocent, not seem guilty, not make things worse than they somehow already become. I was like, should I be talking to a lawyer? And they said, do you want to talk to a lawyer? Did you do something that would necessitate the aid of an attorney? And the other guy's like, if you want a lawyer, we will get you one. But I have to say, that does not look good on you. And I shouldn't have believed them, as my dad has now drilled into my brain, you never talk to police, only your lawyer does. But at the time I thought, yeah, I guess asking for a lawyer does make it seem like I did it. Crap. Then they showed me enhanced frames of the video and timestamps, and they are saying all this stuff. It was really a blur at that point, but one thing in particular stood out. They said something that they had already said a time or two before, but it hadn't totally sunken in until then. They alleged, your buddies thought this would be some quick money. They thought it would be real slick to order a pizza instead of just calling and saying bring the stuff up. At this point, it had been established they thought I transported some large sum of ill-gotten cash into this apartment, and that we wouldn't be suspicious or we wouldn't follow up. I know you're a good guy. You didn't know what you were getting yourself into, but if you're not honest with us, we can't help you. I had told him repeatedly about the other guy who showed up to supposedly deliver a pizza. I even pointed him out on the footage. Unfortunately, the cameras didn't have audio, so they couldn't hear me arguing with the people in the apartment over the measly few bucks. Or more importantly, hear this other guy say pizza. Because the other guy didn't have a pizza box and I did, they didn't believe me that I was in the pizza part of this operation. To recap, apparently what they had uncovered from the real criminals is they were meant to take receipt of some money. The guys inside the apartment were told something like, that afternoon you'll get a pizza, to try and prevent anyone from saying anything incriminating on paper. These dumb fricks in the apartment did not understand the instructions and actually ordered a real pizza instead of just waiting for their cash delivery to show up. I'm pretty certain all of that arguing I'd heard on the phone was one of the other criminals asking something to the effect of, are you sure you're supposed to order an actual pizza? Because what else would they have been arguing about right then? So, once I connected all the dots, it was a matter of proving my pizza delivery was legitimate. They had tried to get a record of the delivery when they talked to my boss, but we were a small shop. We only keep tickets through the end of the week, and we just sign a piece of paper confirming our tip amount every night. These guys wouldn't have factored in since they didn't pay. I didn't have anyone but the criminals to corroborate my story, and there was nothing in it for them to exonerate me, or they would have done it by now. But then I remembered the chef. I told him all about this delivery. I begged the cops to talk to him and reminded them I'd followed them right out of the store before I'd known what this was about, so they could trust he was totally untainted. Sure enough, he recounted it exactly as I told him and told the police. The stories matched near identically. The cops went through our phone logs, but these guys had called in their order from a burner, so that was of no help. I figured a chef would be enough. But after I'd been in a precinct for nearly 8 hours total, they said they were going to go ahead and hold me until they could verify I didn't go with a decoy pizza and somehow give them money another way, or until they found a real delivery guy. They never would, because they didn't believe me that he was the other guy outside of the apartment on the video was out of box. I don't know if he had the cash taped to him or what, but the cops were convinced it couldn't be him, because he didn't have any bag, box, or something to hold the money. Finally, realizing this was not a misunderstanding, that was going to go away. All these years of watching Law & Order kicked in and I asked for my phone call. I got my dad on the line and he of course said don't say another word and showed up with an attorney who had me out within an hour of his arrival. I was formally cleared of all the involvement the next day, barely got an apology. None of this will show up on my record or anything, but still, you'd think they would be a little more remorseful about what they put me through. My boss gave me a couple paid days off, haven't seen how serious it was questioning the chef and searching the phone logs and everything. I think he was just glad I wasn't an embezzler or a serial murderer or otherwise a criminal, because for the longest time, all they would tell him is, I was involved in a situation and they needed information.
And now we have reached the end of today's stories. Thank you for watching and see you next time.